Thank you, choir. Really appreciated your leading us in worship this morning. Let's bow our hearts in prayer. Father, we just thank you for your word. Thank you for the worship, the singing, praise that has already taken part. And we ask you to bless your word to our hearts, enable us to understand. And Lord, I ask that you would speak through me with clarity. And Lord, we ask that your word would come alive in our hearts. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. I'm going to ask if you would stand with me, and we will read from 1 Corinthians chapter 15. Beginning to read in verse 12. Now, if Christ is preached that he has been raised from the dead, how do some among you say that there is no resurrection of the dead? But if there is no resurrection of the dead, then Christ is not risen. And if Christ is not risen, then our preaching is empty, and your faith is also empty. Yes, and we are found false witnesses of God, because we have testified of God that he raised up Christ, whom he did not raise up, if in fact the dead do not rise. For if the dead do not rise, then Christ is not risen. And if Christ is not risen, your faith is futile. You are still in your sins. Then also those who have fallen asleep in Christ have perished. If in this life only we have hope in Christ, we are of all men the most pitiable. But now Christ is risen from the dead and has become the first fruits of those who have fallen asleep. You may be seated. I'm going to begin with a contrasting story to contrast the resurrection of Jesus Christ. It's a story that I have shared with many of you before. Many are familiar with that famous recent historical figure, Harry Houdini. You may not realize that Harry Houdini was a Jew whose real name was Eric Weiss. His father, Samuel Weiss, was a Jewish rabbi. But Harry chose to pursue dark magic instead. This man, known as Houdini, the great magician and escape artist, received powers from the demonic realm. Relying on deceptive information received from the demonic realm, he promised to communicate with his wife from the dead every year on the anniversary of his death. For 10 years, his widow vainly participated in seances on the anniversary of his death, hoping to communicate with her husband. But after 10 years of silence, she gave up. Houdini also, according to some reports, claimed that on the 50th anniversary of his death, he would rise from the dead. He died on Halloween, 1926. So October 31st, 1976, a group of his followers gathered around his grave in Queens, New York, waiting for him to return. They waited and waited and waited and then went home. Houdini, who in life had succeeded in escaping from everything he was ever locked into, in death could not escape from the grave. Only Jesus Christ has triumphed from death, triumphed over the grave. Jesus Christ rose from the dead just as he promised, on the third day after his crucifixion, just as he promised. Many people in history have made all sorts of great claims which they were powerless to fulfill, but our hero, our leader, our Lord Jesus Christ delivered. He came through exactly as he said he would. In Luke chapter 18, when Jesus was walking with his disciples on their way to Jerusalem, remember what he said would happen to them. In verse 31, he took the 12 aside and said to them, "Behold, we are going up to Jerusalem, and all things that are written by the prophets concerning the Son of Man will be accomplished. For he will be delivered to the Gentiles and will be mocked and insulted and spit upon. They will scourge him and kill him, and the third day he will rise again. And that is exactly what happened. And today we are celebrating the fact that on the third day he indeed rose from the dead, just as he said he would. 1 Corinthians chapter 15, the first few verses of that chapter open up with these words, "Moreover, brethren, I declare to you the gospel, the good news, which I preached to you, which also you received, and in which you stand, by which also you are saved, if you hold fast that word which I preached to you." Verse 3, "For I delivered to you first of all that which I also received, that Christ died for our sins according to the Scriptures, and that he was buried, and that he rose again the third day according to the Scriptures, and that he was seen by Cephas, then by the 12, and after that he was seen by over 500 brethren at once." Verse 7, "And after that he was seen by James, and then by all the apostles, and then last of all he was seen by me also." The death and resurrection of Jesus Christ was not just a historical event, but it is the focal point and most important event in all of human history. The most important event in terms of its impact on your life and mine is the death and resurrection of Jesus Christ. For those of you who have put your faith in his death and resurrection as a substitute for you, you can testify that nothing has so profoundly impacted your life. Even the quality of life that we experience from day to day is determined by our daily response to what Jesus accomplished for us through his crucifixion and resurrection. According to the Bible, this is the singular, most supremely important event in all of history, and it deserves our greatest attention and our greatest response. 1 Corinthians 15, reading on, verse 12. The Bible says, "Now if Christ is preached that he has been raised from the dead, how do some among you say that there is no resurrection of the dead?" There were many in the Bible days who did not believe that dead bodies could ever physically rise from the dead. They believed that some mystical form of life after death was possible, but they did not believe in a literal resurrection of the body. People in our own culture today have many different ideas that they have invented about what happens to human beings after death, all kinds of ideas. Some believe in some sort of disembodied spiritual existence as ghosts or maybe as angels that continue to live unseen among us. That's not what the Word of God teaches. Some believe in utter extinction, total annihilation. When you die, that's it. There's nothing after that. Some believe in reincarnation and so on. Many different ideas that people have put forward. But the Bible clearly teaches that there is life after death, and there is coming a day in the future when our physical bodies will be restored and raised from the dead, just as Jesus' body was raised from the dead. In John 6:44, Jesus says, "No one can come to me unless the Father who sent me draws him, and I will raise him up at the last day." To his friend Martha, Jesus said, in John 11:25, "I am the resurrection and the life. He who believes in me, though he may die, he shall live." 1 Thessalonians 4:16, we read, "For the Lord himself will descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of an archangel, and with the trumpet of God, and the dead in Christ will rise first." 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verses 13 through 19. The Bible in those verses demonstrates that the resurrection is essential to the faith by giving seven disastrous consequences if there is no resurrection. If there is no resurrection from the dead, in these verses we read that then Christ has not risen, he is dead. If there is no resurrection from the dead, then the preaching of the gospel is meaningless. faith in Christ is worthless. All witnesses to the resurrection are liars. If there is no resurrection from the dead, all followers of Christ are still in bondage to their sins. All believers who have passed away have perished without hope. And Christians are the most pitiable people on earth. So let's take a quick look at each of these seven statements, which would be true if there is no resurrection. Verse 13, but if there is no resurrection of the dead, then Christ is not risen. Jesus was God, but he limited himself when he came to earth to live as a man. And he lived as a human being on earth. He died as a human being. And if people cannot be raised from the dead, then Jesus did not rise, for he had the body of a man. But when the resurrected Jesus first appeared to his 12 apostles after the crucifixion, he made a point of encouraging the disciples to touch him, in order to prove that he was not simply a spirit. We read in Luke 24, verses 36 to 43, that Jesus himself stood in the midst of them and said to them, now this is on resurrection day, he said, peace to you. But they were terrified and frightened and supposed they had seen a spirit. And he said to them, why are you troubled? And why do doubts arise in your heart? Behold my hands and my feet, that it is I myself. Handle me. And see, for a spirit does not have flesh and bones as you see I have. When he had said this, he showed them his hands and his feet. But while they still did not believe for joy and marveled, he said to them, have you any food here? And so they gave him a piece of broiled fish and some honeycomb, and he took it and ate it in their presence. Jesus was demonstrating to them, proving to them that in his resurrected body, he was indeed a physical being. He had resurrected from the dead. Verse 14, and if Christ is not risen, then our preaching is empty and your faith is also empty. The second consequence of there being no resurrection would be that the preaching of the gospel would be empty, it would be completely meaningless. The heart of the gospel message is Christ's death, burial, and resurrection on our behalf. That is the core, that is the heart, that is the foundation, that is the essence of the good news. We deserve to die, but he died in our place. But he rose again to give us life. Apart from the resurrection, Jesus would not have conquered sin. He would not have conquered death. He would not have conquered hell. And these three great evils would forever conquer all of mankind, leaving us no hope for deliverance. Without the resurrection, the good news would be bad news, and there would be nothing worth preaching. He died, and death conquered him. He took upon himself our sin, and it defeated him. He did not rise. There is nothing to hope for. Our Savior is dead. But praise the Lord, that's not the way it turned out. Without the resurrection, the gospel, though, would be an empty, hopeless message of meaningless nonsense. Unless our Lord had conquered sin and death, making a way for us to follow in that victory, there is no salvation. There is no hope for justice. There's no hope for anything to get better in this world. There's no hope for meaning. There's no hope for purpose in life if Jesus didn't rise from the dead. All believers of all ages would have believed for nothing, lived for nothing, died for nothing if Jesus had not risen from the dead. This resurrection of Christ that we celebrate is vital. Verse 15, yes, and we are found false witnesses of God because we have testified of God that he raised up Christ, whom he did not raise up, if in fact the dead do not rise. If there is no such thing as resurrection of the dead, then every person in the scriptures who claimed to have seen Jesus after he had risen from the dead, and every person who preached and proclaimed that Jesus is alive, is a liar including Paul, including the 12 followers of Christ. To deny the resurrection is to call all of the apostles and every other leader in the New Testament church not simply mistaken, but intentionally deceitful. They would be outright frauds and liars. If the apostles, the prophets that prophesied Christ and his resurrection, and the New Testament writers all lied about the most important teaching of the Bible, why should they be believed about anything else? Why should their moral teachings be considered inspired and noble if they so blatantly lied about the resurrection of Jesus Christ? In fact, the entire Bible stands if Jesus rose from the dead, but if he did not, the entire Bible falls and is useless. However, the credibility of those witnesses to the resurrection of Jesus Christ, over 500 of them, is strengthened by the fact that many of them were pressured to renounce their claims and to keep silent about the resurrection of Jesus. And many of them were threatened with death if they would not keep silent, but they would not keep silent. They proclaimed the good news. Before witnessing the resurrection, some of them, like Paul and James, the brother of Jesus, and his other brothers who opposed Jesus and rejected his claims, changed their minds when they saw the resurrection. And even when beaten, even when imprisoned, even when threatened with death, they would not change their story. They refused to be silent about the resurrection of Jesus Christ. Such self-sacrifice is not characteristic of those who have fabricated a hoax. People do not lie to preserve a fairy tale that they themselves have made up. They do not, die to preserve a fairy tale that they themselves have made up. Verse 16, for if the dead do not rise, then Christ is not risen. And if Christ is not risen, your faith is futile. You are still in your sins. The obvious and additional result of a dead Savior is that believers would be no better off than unbelievers. Followers of Christ would still be bound and controlled by sin. If Jesus did not rise from the dead, then sin won the victory over Christ, and therefore sin would continue to be victorious over all followers of Jesus Christ. But that is not what we see. The transformed lives of the early church and the transformed lives of countless millions of genuine believers since them is evidence that Jesus Christ did rise from the dead and he lives today, and indeed his resurrection life gives power over sin to those who by faith embrace and receive his resurrection as fact and as personally applicable. First Corinthians chapter 6, Paul reminded the Corinthian believers that many of them had previously been fornicators, involved in prostitution and all kinds of sexual immorality. They had formerly been idolaters, adulterers who were cheating on their spouses and causing the breakups of families. Many of them had formerly been homosexuals. Many had been covetous thieves, filling their homes with what they had stolen from others. Many used to be drunkards and abusers of their spouses and beaters of their children. They had once been cruel, sharp-tongued, foul-mouthed revilers, con artists, and extortioners. That was before. But then they heard about Jesus and they believed the good news of his death and resurrection, and their lives were miraculously, radically changed for the better. Their guilt was removed and they became righteous. They became upright, loving, and clean living people through their faith in the risen Lord Jesus. And many of you have been dramatically changed for the better as a direct result of trusting in the resurrected, living Jesus Christ to give you new life. We know one another. We know the before and the after. And we know there is ample evidence in this room that the life of Jesus Christ still changes lives today. Verse 18, then also those who have fallen asleep in Christ have perished. That expression, fallen asleep, was a common euphemism for death. This means that if there is no resurrection from the dead, every believer who has ever died has perished, meaning they are forever separated from God and his goodness. The Apostle Paul, he's gone. Peter, James, John, all in hell if Jesus did not rise from the dead. Mary, Martha, Augustine, Calvin, Luther, Jonathan Edwards, your godly grandmother, and every other believer of every age will spend eternity suffering from a meaningless existence in a place totally isolated from any trace of God and without any hope of any improvement if Jesus did not rise from the dead. Their faith would have been useless. Their sins would remain unforgiven, and their destiny would be damnation. And one day we would all join them in their agony and despair if Jesus Christ had not risen from the dead. And if he did not, there is no hope. Verse 19, if in this life only we have hope in Christ, we are of all men the most pitiable. If you argue that the Christian life is a good life while we're alive, but that's it, the Bible says, no, it's not a good life without Christ. Take out Christ, and the Christian life is the most pitiable of all. Christianity, if it is nothing more than a mere religion, is the least attractive religion according to the Bible. If Christ is missing, if Christ has not risen from the dead, it is a miserable religion. If our hope in Christ proves false in the end, the Bible says that we, followers of Jesus, are to be pitied more than pagan unbelievers. You see, Christianity is all about a person. It's all about Jesus. Take out Jesus, there's nothing left. When we rightly understand and experience true Christianity, the reality of our faith, the good life we experience, the abundant joy we enjoy, the satisfying fulfillment of our walk with him, the peace we experience from his word is all found in a meaningful, dynamic relationship with a real, living God, the resurrected Jesus Christ. The joy that we experience isn't in the religion, but in experiencing the life, the resurrected life of Jesus that he has made available to us. There is no abundant life. There is no true joy. There is no satisfying peace. There is no genuine love. There is no reason to rejoice and sing as we've been doing this morning if you take out Jesus. Mere religion can't do that for you. Jesus calls his followers to deny ourselves daily, to say no to those worldly pleasures and desires, to daily take up our cross, to daily follow him. We are called to embrace suffering, to endure persecution, to endure hardship, which actually brings fulfillment and joy only because it leads us into a deeper and richer experience of the abundant, joyful, resurrected life of Jesus Christ. But if there is no living Christ, such suffering, such persecution would be sheer loss and great tragedy. If Christ is dead, this exercise of self-denial will do nothing more than deprive you of the only pleasures that you are going to experience in this short life, and it's going to rob you of the only temporary life this world would have to offer. But this room is filled with people who can testify that there is no greater joy, there is no greater fulfillment, there is no greater life than what we have experienced in relationship with Jesus Christ. For those of us who have put our faith in the resurrected Christ and have embraced his life as our own life, we can testify to the fact there is nothing more real, there is nothing more fulfilling, there is nothing more satisfying than the indwelling, resurrected life of Christ living through us. He is our life. He is our joy. He is our pleasure. Jesus is our peace, our comfort. He is our strength. Jesus fills our hearts with hope. He gives us a strong sense of meaningful identity, and we experience him as our best friend, one who sticks closer than a brother. For those who have exchanged their life for his, we can say, Jesus is everything in the world to me. This is not just our belief. It is not just wishful thinking. But for those who have entered in by faith, it is our experience. And it is so real that we genuinely pity all the rest of the human race who do not know the living Jesus Christ. Verse 20, but now Christ is risen from the dead, says the word of God, and has become the first fruits of those who have fallen asleep. The first fruits were a small portion of the first part of the harvest that symbolically represented all the rest of the harvest that would follow. The first fruits were a small sample of the rest that was going to come and what it would be like. Whether that harvest was grain or whether it was grapes or apples or whatever, the first portion was representative of the whole. In Proverbs chapter 3, verse 9 to 10, the Bible says, honor the Lord with your possessions and with the first fruits of all your increase. You give to him those first fruits so that your barns will be filled with plenty and your vats will overflow with new wine. The promise of God's word was when you give the first fruits to the Lord, he then guaranteed that the rest of the harvest would be abundant. That is the point of the scripture's illustration here. The fact that Christ's resurrection was called the first fruits indicates that there is much more of the same to follow. Jesus' resurrection was not it. It was just the beginning. In other words, when God raised Jesus from the dead, it served as God's pledge, guaranteeing a much greater harvest to follow, a much greater resurrection to follow. Therefore, in verse 20, by calling Christ the first fruits of those who have fallen asleep, God's word is asserting that the resurrection of all believers who have died is absolutely inevitable. God has promised it's going to happen. It has been guaranteed by God himself, who cannot lie. And his resurrection of Christ is a pledge that the rest of us who trust in him will assuredly follow. If you are a child of God, the resurrection of Jesus from the dead is God's guarantee that when you die, one day your body will awaken from its sleep and rise from the grave. So because Jesus has risen from the dead and is alive forever, the preaching of the gospel is one of the most meaningful things that we can do. Faith in Christ is the most important thing that we can embrace. All witnesses to the resurrection are telling the truth. All followers of Christ are set free from bondage to our sin. All believers who have passed away are with Christ, and one day their bodies will be raised from the dead and they will live again with him on this earth. And Christians are the most blessed and privileged people on the earth because Jesus Christ rose from the grave and he is alive and he lives in our hearts and gives us life and life eternal. Jesus says, I have come that you might have life and have it more abundantly. And those who have taken him up at his word can testify it is true. Jesus has told us to share this good message with everyone that we meet and to invite them to repent of their unbelief, to stop rejecting Jesus, and to receive his life by faith. Everyone is welcome to receive Christ. And that is the message that we want to proclaim to friends and visitors here this morning. This good news is for you. The resurrected life of Jesus Christ is for you. Acknowledge that you are a sinner and that you are in need of a Savior. Believe that Jesus died on the cross for your sins and that he rose again from the dead to give you life. And confess Jesus as your Lord and as your Savior. For the Bible says that if you confess with your mouth Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God has raised him from the dead, you shall be saved. For with the heart you believe unto righteousness, and with the mouth you confess unto salvation. We have experienced this truth, and we celebrate this truth every Sunday, but particularly this Resurrection Sunday. And we want the world to know that Jesus Christ, the Son of God, is life, and he is alive. He is risen from the dead, and he offers his life to all who will receive by faith. Before you go today, we want to give you that opportunity to, by faith, embrace and receive as your Savior and your Lord, Jesus Christ, who is alive and lives forevermore. And when you embrace and receive him, he will give you his life, that you, together with him and the family of God, might live forevermore. Heavenly Father, we thank you that you so loved the world, that you gave, you generously, abundantly, sacrificially gave your only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish, but have everlasting life. Thank you. Thank you. And Lord Jesus, we thank you that you so loved us, you went to the cross. You endured the pain, scorned the shame, and you died in our place. And oh, Lord, how we thank and praise you that you rose again on the third day, demonstrating you had indeed triumphed over sin. You had indeed conquered the grave, and you took up eternal life and offer it to all. And Lord, we thank you that we can today enter in and receive that which you died to make available to us. I pray that you would cause faith to arise in our hearts. I pray, Lord, that you would convict us of our need of a Savior. And Lord, may we recognize that you are the way, the truth, and the life, that no one comes to the Father except through you, Jesus. And Lord, I ask for the power and the anointing of your Holy Spirit to be upon this congregation, that as we go out from here into this world, that we would go with the joy of the Lord in our hearts, that we would go with the proclamation of this good news spilling forth from our lips, and Lord, that we would go with the evidence of the resurrected life of Christ evident in our lives, in our actions, in our conversation. And I pray this in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. Amen.